spent the weekends with my grandparents. I suppose if my parents were able to have five kids. But when they moved to the farm, we had always enjoyed it. When they moved to the farm, it became an adventure. We looked forward to every weekend. My grandmother would stop by and pick us up on Friday afternoon, and the first stop was Kroger's, where we could load that grocery cart with anything and everything we wanted, which of course was all the junk food we weren't allowed to eat at home. It worked out okay. She was engulfed in my parents' coffee. Our next stop was a farm, and the five of us simply exploded out of that car, because there were 20 acres of woods and fields filled full of arrowheads and other Indian arrows, and pastures and creeks with fossils and crawdads and all sorts of other interesting things. And there were old houses and barns and haylofts. There was a whole world peaceful, and a start we did until it began to get dark. And then we'd need a path back to the house. And we'd sit on the front porch with my grandmother, my grandfather once later, and we finish up the lawn. And my grandmother would tell us stories. She was a wonderful storyteller. And she'd tell stories as the darkness fell. And then when it got completely dark, all around us, she'd suddenly become dark. What sort of house turn on the lights? We had played after dark before, but there were street lights. And the only voices we heard, the only sounds we heard, were kids yelling back and forth with each other. And laughter, and our parents calling us, telling us it was time to come in. And on the farm was a totally different story. It was dark. But only God in that, all that darkness, with the lamp in our neighbor's window across the road. And there were all sorts of sounds in that darkness. Loud, persistent. All around was this great cotton. Now, it was a surprise when they came back. I was a little bit scared of the kids. And we sat there one evening, and my grandfather said, "Listen. You hear? Well, I hear everything out there. What do you mean, do I hear? Listen. That sound, half of the kind of screech and the knock. Now, someone's telling me all the nasty sound and the sound is going to sound so low. I got a man here. He said, "Wow, we're going to be bound to look for food." He said, "Now, listen real close." And the way he could have felt his wings at the top. And I was sleeping around. And I was listening. And I felt it worse. And I could hear my mother crying.
She was smiling that you can't hear.
And the barns were winning, and shuffling around. And I went soft. And gradually, over time, the kids began to be able to identify all sorts of noises. And not just moving calves and bleeding goats and sheep, but bleeding and barking dogs. But you know, my grandmother came back. Ah, there's a dog still thin now. That's a pretty thin. We hear this laugh today. And we hear the beagle jumping and running through the grass. And that's where we can tell the difference between the bark of a dog and the bark of a fox and the bark of a squirrel. And take the frogs and the chickens and the hen house as the fox tried to get in. And peer back in and speak to you as they can test the doors and rocks and bring them in. There were all sorts of sounds out there. And now they began this great years, ten of them, and Davis also went on. So the denominational people don't identify the sacraments, and they also don't sit around out speaking to them and ask them to speak the gospel. Today's gospel. We see crowds gathered around Jesus. Mark places it since early in Jesus' public ministry. But Jesus has still been out there long enough to get a reputation, so he's out there preaching and healing and casting out demons. And people might not know exactly what's going on, but they sense that something new and different than exciting is happening in their midst. And part of that crowd is gathered. They want to experience that miraculous healing for themselves. Others in the crowd help compare to the community of the poor. Maybe the family. That's so, is this not almost time? Whenever it stops, the religious belief of their day, praying in the tradition of Israel, with all the knowledge of how God worked in our past, and with the knowledge of the law God has given us. And they know all the ins and outs of the law, all the nuances, all the subtleties, and how to apply. They've been trained in the knowledge and in the traditional thinking that prophecy came to an end centuries ago with Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. But ever since then, God has remained silent, leaving the law to mediate the relationship with God. And that very thing, that very knowledge, comes along the concept that God built in a new and different way, right here in our midst. And as they cast around and follow around looking for, what is it? Why is he able to do the things he does? The only thing they can be done with is, who must he possess? He can only fulfill the law. And Jesus wastes no time in letting him know how ridiculous that is, how illogical that is, how it could never happen. And Jesus also warns them to think in your future because of how simple it is when you call the only good evil. It's a warning. It's a caution. To not be so tied down in tradition. And in your learning, and in what you know and what you think, and in your own opinions, to not be so confident that you're blind to the action of God around you, that you're blind to the movement of God in your midst. He's coming to support you later. Be open to something new. Those words. It serves as the one for us today, too. The world is becoming increasingly noisy for us. There are lots of people and thousands of things out there allowing our attention. And I wonder how many times we shut them off because they don't, that word isn't coming close in a traditional way. How many times we shut them off because we don't agree with them or it makes us uncomfortable. Or it's not the traditional way we're accustomed to hearing God speak. We expect God to speak to us in our church. We expect to hear the voice of God in instruction, in our prayers, in our meditations. But how about when we're reading the newspaper, or we're listening to the news, or we're walking down the street? We expect someone to confront us with the word of God, someone to proclaim the gospel to us in a new and different way. And have been really tuned our ears to listen to that. Said if you're comfortable with the gospel, then you haven't really heard it. Gospel's not there to make us comfortable, but it's there to challenge us. And when we allow ourselves to be challenged, that's what leads to interest. My parents always concerned to provide us with experiences that would help us grow, help mold us into good, solid, useful adults. Several years after my grandparents bought their farm, one summer when I was in junior high school, my father decided to take me to Washington, D.C. hear Martin Luther King and others speak at the Lincoln Memorial. He decided he would drive, and I wasn't too happy with that decision. In fact, our trip did not start off all that well, because my parents' best friends had offered to fly us there in their plane. I would have much preferred that long trip with my father. But he decided to drive, and I wasn't happy about it. You know how 14-year-olds can be. But gradually things warmed up, and we started talking. We stopped and visited relatives in Chattanooga and in Knoxville. And then we went on and visited relatives and friends in Maryland. And then we arrived in D.C. And I had been there before. I had visited there several times. But I was totally unprepared for what I saw that day. I have never seen so many people gathered together in one place, packing so tightly as that day. And there was an energy in the air. There was the excitement. There was an electricity. You could feel it. And we settled in to listen. And we listened to the first several speakers. And then Dr. King came to the podium. He started speaking, and people were attentive. And then he said, "I still have a dream." And suddenly you just feel the electricity through the group. I was totally enthralled. The trip back home was quiet. We just remained silent. And I knew why my father had wanted to drive rather than fly with friends. And gradually we began talking. We talked about hopes and dreams. We talked about disappointment. We talked about prophets in the Old Testament and prophets in modern times. We talked about prophetic vision. We talked about conviction. We talked about justice and righteousness and the gospel and all of God's children being equal. We talked about fairness and equality and inequality. We talked about our society. We talked about our country. We talked about things that need to change and things that need to be lifted up. It was a pivotal moment. It was a formative moment in my life. My father summed it all up. He said, "Karen," he said, "always be open. Always keep your eyes and ears open and being aware of how God might be at work in the world around you." never, ever let your prejudice or your bias, either yours or those of others, keep you from hearing the word of God, no matter who proclaims it, and no matter from what quarter it comes from. Let something that stayed with me. God works the world in all sorts of mysterious ways. God's voice can be heard in the voices of those around us, in the groups around us, calling for justice, calling for freedom. God's voice speaks to us today in voices we're not accustomed to hearing, in voices we're not accustomed to paying attention to. Yes, sometimes the voices that make us uncomfortable, but God does speak. I hope that all of you have been given that gift of listening and discernment. I thank my grandparents and my parents for that. For giving me the gift of, for training me to listen, for tuning my ears up, and for giving me the wisdom and the knowledge to discern what was going on, not just identifying where the voices came from, but what was behind them. It makes the world an interesting place and a challenging place. But it is God's world and God's creation, and God continually speaks through it. You weren't lucky enough to get that gift as a child. It's never too late.